Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon.
It's always a challenge to be a speaker after lunch. Bear with me because I'm going to not only use my laptop, I'm also going to pull Arulu. I'm going to use my iPhone as well. But not for other reasons other than just complimenting what I'm going to be speaking about. So I wanted to speak about self-love and health. We could probably give many lectures on this topic. We could talk about many different aspects of self-love and health. Coming from the healthcare field, we can divide health. We can talk about health in many different aspects: mental health, emotional health, physical health. But as Louise Lima, there he is, he did a great service to my talk. Because I don't need to speak too much on health, because he really covered the idea of us being this three-dimensional, or rather five-dimensional, and very all bodies, beings. But me, the immortal spirit, us as immortal beings, what I do will reverberate back into the other bodies of who I am. But allow me to share something. Something very interesting that we feel that we can respectfully say this, the mentors guided us to share this, this idea of self-love. And our society, it's very interesting how it's defined nowadays with self-help gurus and everyone wanting to teach you different things. But one of the realities of life is, how do we go about teaching self-love? This is a question obviously we have to ask ourselves. Let me share a true story that happened around 2001. And it was the story of a 16-year-old boy and his stepfather. And before we continue on with this story, we ask, and kindly we ask, that as I tell this story, it's quite dramatic, it's a true story, but when we begin to mentalize, because as we learned earlier today with Mr. Lima, we send out mental waves. And we want to send these two people who are still alive our blessings. In 2001, a 16-year-old boy along with his stepfather set out, planned. They were known as sniper shooters. And most recently, the Washington Post interviewed that 16-year-old boy who's now 26. And it's fascinating what he said. You can imagine what he might say. Washington Post wasn't the only entity that actually interviewed him. There were other radio shows that wanted to. So we see already how our society is. We bring about this illustrious crimes, and it's sad in a way, but also educational. Because let me read to you what he said to the Washington Post. He said, in a rare interview, he said to them, in reference to the killings, in reference to one of the people that he shot, her name was Linda Franklin, and he said, the look on the face of the victim of Linda Franklin's husband right after he shot her stands out in my memory. Franklin was a 47-year-old FBI analyst. She was killed by her husband while loading supplies outside a Home Depot in Falls Church, Virginia. Malvo, who was the shooter, he said, the look on the face of her husband, his eyes, they are penetrating. It is the worst sort of pain I have ever seen in my life. His eyes, words do not possess the depth in which to fully convey that emotion and what I felt when I saw it. You feel like the worst piece of scum on the planet. He's now serving a life sentence with no possibility of parole at a prison in Southwest Virginia for killing Franklin and others. How do you teach someone like this about self-love? How? As spiritists, if we receive someone at our fraternal counseling meeting and confesses this, perhaps he wasn't caught and confesses, how do we console the hearts those who commit atrocities. We, whether I do not pretend to stand up here and do such a thing, but hope to share. And as Joana DeAngelis just says in the book, existential conflicts. In the book, Existential Conflicts, in the chapter entitled Love, she says, and we're paraphrasing here, so forgive us, Joana, but it only takes a spark, someone to inspire us, a moment for us to change. We were given the blessing of listening to Arundo's talk in these past couple days, last week in Virginia and Maryland. And it takes a spark of someone standing up here, and sometimes not standing up here, sitting behind the scenes, to be a catalyst for change. Now, we don't know what was the spark of young Malvo, but we know one thing for sure. If the laws of God are written in our conscience, and as Arundo recently uses the analogy of a compass, they guide us. And fortunately or unfortunately for him, his conscience woke up, and he's now coming to the realization of what he did. How do we console the hearts of people who have done atrocities? And what if you haven't committed an atrocity? What if you just made some little mistakes? You haven't done anything big? Maybe you lied here and there. How do we console those hearts? And why is it worth it? Let us share something as well from Emmanuel. It's in the introduction of the book, And Life Goes On. And he says the following. A worthy construction does not occur without the cooperation of work and time. Just as rashness or violence are not part of the divine plans that oversee the universe. So the case of Malvo, his rashness, his violence, is not part of his divine plan. For sure we can say this. For sure we can say that. But now, his road to redemption, just like the road to Damascus, was for Paul, it's the same for all of us. The same inner compass he had, we all have. Part 3 of the Spirit's book, the divine natural laws. Each one of us has it. But it's a worthy work. But it takes work and time. Something interesting that Joana DeAngelis says as well. She says, At no time, can you find the instruction, be loved. On the contrary, in all the teachings, the rule is always to love. So when we talk about self-love, sometimes we have misconceptions. We are waiting for someone to love us, or waiting for perhaps that knight in shining armor, or that moment, or meeting a series of different people in our lives to feel that love. We're waiting for the inspiration to come. Joana says, nowhere in the teachings do you find said, be loved. It's the opposite. Love. So on this journey of our talk today, we will not be discussing how you can wait for your knight in shining armor, how many ways you can dye your hair to attract that knight in shining armor, or how to take spa vacations. And we don't down that. We don't say that, you should never take out time for yourself. We're not saying that. But we're also saying that's not the end all to be all. It's so much more than that. That a 30-minute lecture can never come close to fulfilling and answering the questions of our souls. Because we don't come to lectures like this, we don't come to seminars, because the hardest difficult thing I'm dealing with is what kind of car I'm going to get next year. The hardest things we endure are our relationships with people. Because we are social beings. And it is, by the way, one of the laws. law society. We are meant to be amongst each other. And it's the best way for us to learn. Something for us to think about. Let's remember that. I am to love, not to be loved. And Joanna, that same book I mentioned earlier, Existential Conflicts, which it is in English, believe it or not, she says that when you're loving, you should take measure how much you're loving. She doesn't say go and measure how much your husband, your partner, your sister, your mother, your enemies are loving you. She says you measure how much you're loving. Is it enough? Are you waiting for reciprocity, for someone to reciprocate? Because that is not the idea of self-love. But to really, before we go into depth for making sense today, bear with me. I'd like to share a case from this book, Between Heaven and Earth. Yay, it's in English. 10, 15 years ago, growing up in the Sirius movement, I think the first book that came out was in Al-Salar, I think I was 11. Growing up, I see our children now, they are quite blessed and lucky. And forgive me for saying this one small personal tidbit. I turned to my daughter recently, who looked like she was zoning out when we were listening to Otto's talk because it's in Portuguese, but I said, you know, you're quite lucky, because when I was your age, there was no translation. I had to sit and listen to people and how other people. But anyway, the case of Mario Silva, very interesting. Of course, we're passionate about the book, all the spiritual literature, the André Luiz collection, Psychographs by Chico Xavier is amazing. At any point, you can just open up any page and find something uplifting. The case of Mario Silva, very interesting, and it's too long to tell you the whole story, and I won't ruin it for you. You should go buy the book. You could probably go to etusei.com and purchase the book online. Where it actually might have it in the back. So I'll give you a brief overview of his story. Mario was a healthcare practitioner, and one day he was called to the home of his ex-fiance, whose son was dying of croup. So we see at what time and point this story is dated, because nowadays we have vaccines for croup, otherwise known as whooping cough. So that's not really an issue. But at that time, the vaccine for it was just coming out. So you can imagine, Mario Silva, many years prior, was engaged to a woman named Zulmira. Zulmira was the love of his life, but she left him, broke it off, engagement, and she went and married somebody else. He continued to talk about self-forgiveness. He continued to hold the resentment for a number of years. Because one day, he was called to go to her home to help her dying son, who's about 1 year old. And André Luiz paints the picture so dramatic, like a soap opera. I always tell anyone who isn't sure about spiritism, I always point them towards the André Luiz collection because it's like a soap opera. He gets to the house, he sees his ex, not ex-lover, but someone who used to love a lot. So those emotions come up and he's so conflicted and he sees a young boy dying. And André Luiz tells us, ties in so well with what Luiz Lima was talking about earlier, the way his thoughts began to generate. He began sending these negative energy to the dying boy. But luckily, the mentors that were there covered the boy, so it was deflected from him. So all this went on, and the boy did wind up dying. He goes home. That's the end of that particular scene. But later is what happens most significant. He begins to become so conflicted by what happened. So you see where the laws of conscience call our attention. No one needs to call Mario and say, Mario, hey, what did you do? You're having bad thoughts. The only person who called his attention was himself. And that's all that's really needed. That's why we never need to preoccupy ourselves with judging anyone. Because for sure, It's an auto-regulatory system that God has so divinely created us. There's no need to tell anyone, really, because eventually we figure it out. It's all self-regulating. He began to feel really bad, and to cut a really long story short, he was drawn back to the home with the help of a woman who was spiritist. She brings him back to help him to recuperate the situation. And what's most beautiful is the interaction. And one part I failed to tell you was that the mother of the young little boy fell into a deep depression. She fell into a deep depression for many reasons that you have to go and read the book for. But the fact that she lost a child, and anyone who's ever lost a child or a sibling or a loved one, you know what that pain is like. So he goes there. And the higher spirits, Clarencio and Andrea Luis and other spirits, are helping them to come back together, to repair. And what's so beautiful is when Mario and Zomira, when they get together, this is what self-love and health is about. He was guided to go back there, not just to offer assistance to the mother, to the family, but also for himself. So that's why oftentimes we confuse self-love with ego, self-aggrandizement. I want to put myself up here. It's nothing to do with that. Nothing to do with that at all. You can love yourself and be extremely humble. I'm not talking about self-deprecation. I'm talking about honoring the immortal being that I am. So he goes and he offers his assistance. And I'm paraphrasing all this because I want you to go and meet someone who's entirely moving. And before we post this statement, you have to understand how Andrea's depicted the story. Mario was so disturbed in his mental field because of the guilt. Why was he disturbed because of the guilt? He didn't kill the little boy. Andrea Luis explains that he already was in that little boy's reincarnatory plan to die for other reasons. So it had nothing to do with Mario. He didn't die because of Mario. But Mario felt like he was a murderer. Why? For the reason that Luis Lima explained to us about mental field, and also because the laws of God are in our conscience and call to attention. And at the end, he completely changed. His emotional field changed. And Andrea Luis tells us this. He felt reconciled with himself and radiated his silent joy of someone who found happiness again. This is what we hope to give to the man who just realized he committed atrocities by killing many people. How do you give comfort to someone who, whether it is believed or true, that they committed an atrocity? Because sometimes we think we did something when in reality we didn't. Not in the usual way we think, like Mario Silva, though he didn't kill the boy, but in his thoughts, that's what he wanted to do. So when we understand self-love, it goes so much deeper than just taking care of your physical body, finding time for yourself. It's about addressing us as the immortal being, as the immortal soul that we are, and the emotional component that we are. Let's understand a little bit what Joanna Danny says about the psychogenesis of love. Because how can we begin to understand self-love? Where does love come from? How does it come about? We talk about beautiful things in the literature. That's what spiritism is, right? It's like having a Maserati in your garage. But if you don't drive it, what's the point? I use this analogy because it's easy for us to contextualize it. Or for the women, if I have Tiffany's jewelry, but it's always kept in my safe, what good is it? That's what the spiritist teachings are. What good are the teachings if we don't apply it, we don't use it? We don't say that they serve no purpose, but they're being dormant. Who does it serve? Joanna says in this book, Evolution of Two Worlds, reason recently the Spirit Society of Baltimore, is translating it. So thanks to that, we have parts of it in English. And Jeremy said something very interesting. He talks about the evolution of our emotions, the evolution of us as beings. And also Joanna DeAngelis in the same book, Existential Conflict, she talks about the psychogenesis of love, how love develops over time. For those of you who think that this is boring, I do apologize. But it's quite necessary to know where we're going. Sometimes it's necessary to know where we've come from, to know that we've had come a long way. We still have a really long way to go still. But we've made some leaps and bounds. She says, it is in that phase that the future constitution of the ego will be shaped, while the intelligent principle, although asleep, begins the elaboration of the individual itself. And in the book, Evolution to World, we learn that love exists in an embryonic stage, unfolding over centuries, unfolding of sensations to instincts in animal forms. When a protoplasm or an amoeba is created, per the book, there's higher spiritual beings. And we can imagine this for a second. Well, it seems funny. You see all these heavenly beings coming over at an amoeba? It seems kind of comical. But it's actually not. Right there and right there is a perfect example of this divine love that is with us from the very beginning. From the very beginning, we are assisted. And in that, in those earliest stages, per Andrea Luis and Joanna DeAngelis is where love begins. And Joanna also talks about how in the animal kingdom, the beginning stages of love, when we see a mother dog licking her cub, or in this case a lion, those are the very rudimentary sentiments of love that they're there, that one day will turn into a mother kissing her newborn child. Which, by the way, they say is the closest idea here on earth we can have of God's love for us, because it's unconditional. And we would be remiss in not touching on the area of modern-day psychology. Abraham Maslow, he talks about something very interesting. Self-love and self-esteem kind of coincide, because what is self-love? Feeling good about who I am. Maslow's hierarchy of needs, he says there are stages we have to go through. First, I have to fulfill my basic needs. I have to eat, I have to drink before I go to the next stage. Of feeling safe and secure. And what's interesting, Maslow had this idea, not unlike many others, that to be the best of who I am, which he called self-actualization, right before I hit the peak of my moral perfection, he says, we need to achieve good self-esteem, which in today's talk would translate to self-love. Before I can make that pass, go above that extra step, evolve a little bit more, I need to have good self-esteem, which is interesting. Because Joanna DeAngelis says the following, in chapter 19 of Existential Conflict, she says, love yourself in order to love your neighbor, and by consequence, to love God. Someone can only love another if he loves himself. So, when Jesus taught us to love thy neighbor, does it sound contradictory that Joanna DeAngelis is saying, well, don't love another when I love myself? It's not contradictory, actually. It's instructional. It's instructing us, lovingly, to work on ourselves. But it's quite difficult if I cannot realize my own self as being an immortal being of God, a child of God, much less looking at my neighbor, much less Mr. Malvo who committed this atrocity. It'd be nearly impossible for me to look and listen on the news and say, oh, what a poor guy, to have compassion for him. Or even better, if your cousin or uncle, someone around you at your job, it's even more difficult. If I don't love myself, it's very difficult for us to have good relationships with my self-esteem as well. My self-love is just not there. But don't worry, because it can be there. William James will help us with this. He will help us with this idea. He actually coined the term self-esteem. And it's right around the time, you could say, in history, in our era, 1890s, he wrote probably what came to be the most influential text in modern psychology. It's called The Principles of Psychology. And in Spiritism, we know him for the spiritual aspects as well. He talked about the immortality of the soul, many of the other aspects, which unfortunately we don't have time to go to depth about, but we recommend you reading about. It's very interesting what he says about self-esteem. He explained that people's self-esteem, self-worth, self-love, depends on the values they place on various factors in their lives. What does that mean? For instance, if I don't care if I have a Maserati or not, or better yet, if I don't care if I have Tiffany's bracelets or not, if someone gives it to me, terrific. But my self-esteem is not based on that. But if my self-esteem is based on getting a Tiffany's bracelet and I don't get it, my self-esteem is low. So this is a really rough analogy, but this is what Mr. James is talking about. If I have conditions on certain things, our self-esteem are based on those conditions. So it would behoove us to find out what conditions I have, because oftentimes they are the roadblocks to our own self-love. What are the conditions I place in my life for me to feel good about myself? By the way, one of the things we didn't share about Mr. Malvo that he recently released during several interviews, and he hadn't released before, and probably hadn't released to his mother. His stepfather, by the way, at the age of 16 and many years prior, had been raping him, sexually abusing him. And we say this, we know that it's shocking, but we see the mind of the young child that was already corrupted at a young age. And thank God Spiritism comes in and explains all of this to us. Although we don't know all the behind-the-scenes story, that's why we cannot judge. Because how many of you in this room, prior to me telling you that one tidbit, how many of you now feel more compassion for him? You don't have to raise your hands. How many of you feel a little bit more bad for him now that I told you that? Maybe just a little bit. Shows a part of his humanity. And it still shows a part of where we are at. But the most interesting thing is what he said to a news broadcaster. He wanted the victims, the family of the victims that were alive. He said to them, don't think about me anymore. Don't allow what I did to you to imprison you for the rest of your life. Because I am my own prison. And we're paraphrasing. But it's shocking for someone to commit that atrocity and to have that type of insight to say that to the victims of his family. Don't allow me to imprison you. That's a gift. And it's an amazing gift because he's trying to help his victims. Because the family that lived on were also his victims. And we use air quotes here because Spiritism, we know that everything happens for a reason. God is not unjust when he allows things to happen. And we're not here today to present a bunch of research, because research can be really boring sometimes, especially if you're not in the field. But we have to bring all aspects. And I'd like to believe if Kardec was here today, if he was alive in the physical body, I should say, because he's somewhere. that he'd be using the iPad, the iPhone, the i-whatever, every avenue to get the message, to share the message. There was an interesting research that was done. It actually was based upon William James's theories on self-esteem. It was done in 2011. It was entitled The Importance of Importance in a Visible Self, Support for the Theoretical, Appealing but Empirically Elusive Model of James. I know it sounds really long and boring, but it's actually really interesting what they found. And what William James said actually has weight. It actually makes sense. They found that in a study that people who valued their individual abilities tended to have higher self-esteem. They also found that awareness of one's physical attractiveness was important for self-esteem and self-worth. And that people who rated themselves low for a particular ability did not let their feelings negatively affect their self-esteem. So we see, there's many different aspects of self-esteem, and it affects people differently. But definitely, as we can see here, that what importance we give to certain things will affect us. Let's contextualize a little bit better. I have a cousin. Hypothetically, it's not really true. I do have cousins, but...
not
this one. Right. I have a cousin. And by the way, I'm not this way. I'm the kind of person that I love to be remembered on my birthday. Love it. And I really feel good about it. I have a cousin that we're close, but every year she forgets my birthday. And so that, over the years, has really created an issue, not so much in my self-esteem, because I care about her, and I know she cares about me, but it makes me feel bad, because I put that condition on that. But what if? What if I say, I'm going to still feel good about myself. I don't need to put that condition there. I don't need to give that importance. But that's hard, because we are conditioned beings. From the time we are living in the animal kingdom for centuries, we're conditioned because that's how we live. We survive off being conditioned. Can you imagine if an antelope is being chased by a lion? If she wasn't conditioned to run, say, oh, okay, I'm just frolicking around. She died, she wouldn't live. Neither would any other antelope. So it's important. So we're coming out of that animal kingdom. So we are used to being conditioned, but we can recondition it. Thanks to neuroscience and the neuroplasticity of the brain, we know that old dogs can learn new tricks. And that's why all of us are in this room, because we're trying to learn new tricks, new habits. Why? Because we're already happy already, we don't need anything. Because each one of us has something we have either suffered over or are suffering with, however small it is. It may not be Mr. Malvo, but it's something that we are enduring. One of the others also says something interesting as well. Something for us to reflect about. When she talks about the immortal being, human beings especially, that's the term she uses, human beings. She says, empty human beings roam in all directions, lost from their existential path, become drunken on fanciful dreams to avoid themselves and others. So when we see society as we know it, squandering their time, respectfully to say that, wasting their time on, as Joanna says, fanciful dreams, because that encompasses a whole lot of things, it's because we're lost. But don't worry. We have the eternal compass, it's there. And sooner or later, and most oftentimes through a great deal of pain, we are shifted back for our alignment, most often because of pain. Pain has such a bad rap. Such a bad rap. I had pain, where's my Tylenol, where's my Motrin? I went away. Pain, when you read Joanna DeAngelis, when you read the Valley's collection, pain is redefined for us. It's redefined as a tool to educate. No longer this idea of self-deprecation. Oh, I'm suffering. Woe is me. No, pain is good. Because when our compass is either beginning to get off or it's really off, pain will break up. In the same way, when a child, this is an easy analogy I can give, child learns not to put his hand in the fire because ouch, it hurts. But oftentimes, unfortunately, we find ourselves time and time again putting our hand in the fire. Until we develop, I think it's called crocodile skin.
Elephant skin.
Especially when we begin to learn the necessity of pain to a point where it's no longer painful anymore. If we evolve out of that. Joanna says this for us to also reflect. That those who stray off the beaten path, when we look at someone, it's so easy for us to judge and say, look at them, look what they've done. Here she's being kind. We see that the level of Joanna DeAngelis, where she's at, for those of you who don't know who Joanna DeAngelis is, she's the mentor and guide of Divaldo Franco at Brazilian Spiritist Medium. At the level that she is, the level of moral perfection that she's reached, she can easily come and say, who are you? Look at you. I'm above you. She doesn't say that. She does better than us. And she says, look at them. It's sad. Have we ever seen a drunken man in the street battling to himself or a drunken woman? It's a pitiful sight. So when she says this, it's to inspire a little bit of compassion for us first, as spiritists, and everyone across the world. Let's utilize Emmanuel a little bit, because he's so good at teaching us about love. He says, in the book, The Pathway of Truth and the Life, which is in English, by the way, he says the following. It is important to recognize that your intellectual achievements are very important. Your inquiries have substantial value, but in truth, you only will be an effective and efficient cooperator of Christ if you have love. Paul said that as well, in different words. Emmanuel is not discounting any degrees. He's not saying your bachelor degree in IT, in molecular biology, oh, that's worthless. No, it has value. It has value. The hard work that you do has value. But if you have all these things, if you have not love, then we will not be an effective and efficient cooperator of Christ. So just by a raise of hands, who does not wish to be an effective and efficient cooperator of Christ? Does anyone not want to be that? No. Does anyone want to be that? Yes. What a glorious thing. What a glorious thing to feel and to know that we can be cooperators, effective and efficient cooperators of Christ. And just to give you a little bit of an idea, I don't know how many of you have ever met Chico or Divaldo, but perhaps you've met someone else in your life, and when you met them, they made a big impact on you. It could be one of your favorite aunts. It could be a great neighbor. They're just such a loving, kind person. It could be your physician. And when you come in their presence, you feel modified. You feel like I didn't know I was so thirsty until I sat down next to you and I had a conversation with you. We had this experience recently. Because sometimes we get off that beaten path. But thank God, Spirit isn't here to tell us that we always have an opportunity of renewal, of redemption, of a time that I misuse and it's lost forever. Never get that back. There's a story, I'm going to paraphrase a story about Shiko because I heard it through someone else. If my memory doesn't fail me, I actually think I heard it from Vanessa. The story about Shiko where a man, and forgive me if the minor details are incorrect, but the minor details aren't as important as to what Shiko said. A rich man who had always been waiting to do work in spiritism. He worked with Shiko. Finally, getting towards the end of his life, he said, Shiko, I'm gonna go and work. I'm going to make up for all those years and years and decades of not working. And Shiko, in his kind and humble, gentle way, said, well, you can get those years back, but you can go ahead and do all the work moving forward. Do you know what happened to that man? My memory serves me right. I believe he died very soon thereafter. It was a week or two later he died. And for those of you who read Portuguese, I recommend you to read the book Torments of Obsession. I'm not going to attempt to read that title in Portuguese because I'm going to flog myself. But it is in the process of being translated. But it's an amazing account by an author whose name is very difficult to pronounce. He is an American. Manuel Filomena de Miranda, psychographed by Eduardo Franco. It's an amazing account, true stories of when spiritists disincarnate and go to the spiritist hospital, Hospital Esperanza. It is shocking. Right when you read it. It's life-altering, really, when we think about us as immortal beings. So what I mentioned about knowing people, either if you met Chico or Duval or someone, doesn't be any of those people, a neighbor, a loved one, a mother, who changed your life, isn't that sensation of that love you feel from them, does it change our perspective? Or if you had a conversation with someone, and prior to having that conversation, you were not feeling so great, and then your perspective changed? Has anyone ever had that? Yes? Joanna says, love changes perspectives. In the book, Open Your Heart and Find Happiness, she says the following. With the feeling of love expanded, you will forgive more easily, as you will understand others, the opponent, the adversary, and the persecutor. They are angry with themselves, sick without knowing it, and needing help. This is like the Tiffany's bracelet of spiritism. It's beautiful. It's lovely to talk about, to converse about. But serves no purpose unless we actually use it and utilize it to change our lives. Poetry only becomes poetry in life when we apply it. Otherwise, it's like something beautiful that we adorn our walls with. And when guests come over and say, look how beautiful. But it serves no purpose. I'll be over parentheses here. If you have beautiful furniture, Tiffany's bracelet, there's something wrong with that. We're not trying to downgrade that, just to prove a little bit of a point. What Joanna's saying here is a way for us to detect if love has truly entered yet into the space here, or here, or all over here. Because you change as a person. Your life is modified, even if it's slightly, but you change. Did Mr. Malvo change? Maybe. His words are striking and piercing to the hearts of the victims, families who are still alive, and for us. We're nowhere near what happens to him and his victims, but it pierces our hearts, not just for the victims, but to realize that yet that young man who will never leave that physical prison realizes, and that is the most saddest part, and the part we should feel compassion for, when you realize that you made a really big mistake. But thank God for reincarnation. Thank God for the opportunities that we have to redeem ourselves. Spiritism teaches us to become more aware, to know what it is to love ourselves. What is the first step? Because in this conversation that we hope to have, and we hope we are having with one another, Joanna says, it is necessary to become aware of the values of the eternal spirit in order to achieve identification with oneself and with the goodness. What are the values of the eternal spirit? Does anyone know? No? How can we become aware of something that we don't even know what it is? It's necessary to become aware of the values of the eternal spirit in order to achieve identification with oneself and with the goodness, and we could say with God. Allow us to offer some help in this regard. In the Spirit's Book, Part 3, there are 10 divine laws that whether you're Muslim, Hindu, Spiritist, not Spiritist, Catholic, everybody has it written in their conscience. Values of the eternal spirit. In the opening introduction of the Divine Natural Laws, the Spirits tell us something very interesting. They actually tell us that our happiness can be found by aligning ourselves with the Divine Natural Laws. Our happiness is there. Wow. Guys, you don't need to go out and buy Deepak Chopra's recent book. You just need to buy the Spirit's Book. That's it. Well, the rest of the books as well. I'm sorry. But if you were searching for happiness, which probably if I pulled the room, to some degree or another, we're searching for our happiness. Joanna goes even farther to say that in this self-actualization, in this process of self-realization, finding our self-esteem, finding our self-love, so there's three aspects. Simple, very simple. Love, forgive, and serve. And you can't just do one without the other. Because in the first story, or the second story, I illustrated the case of Mario Silva. He found his self-love and his health. And he was able to go back, forgive, and what? Serve. A very important element sometimes is left out in the American society. If you study William James, you study the literature in the late 1800s, you see this insurgence of our society of wanting to do this self-help. Do good, practice good, work on myself. But it seems like at some point, the road where those two should have been kept together, it bifurcated. They went separate ways. And now it seems like in our society, it's all about making me feel great. It's not anymore about serving anyone else anymore. And it should be. As Joanna says, it's important for us to go and study the 10 divine laws. It's interesting because just by show of hands, how many of us know how the inner workings of your heart works? Sort of kind of, you know, pump stuff out. Circulate stuff around. I know that I'm up here. My heart's probably working. Probably. You know, things work in there. There's electrical components, there's mechanical components. So it's not so important for us to in depth know about the inner workings of our heart, but it is important to know that the laws that are written in my conscience, it's important to know what those laws are. Because they're here within me. They will help me, my moral compass. And last but not least, achieving this self-love. We leave you with Joanna, because as we'd like to respectfully call her, a psychologist of spiritism. She says, development happens by the moral contribution of the individual's efforts. To acquire independence, to be capable of loving, practicing self-love, overcoming insecurity, fear, and all other emotions that she talks about in the book Existential Conflicts that inhibit us and impede our progress. So we leave you with this last thought, that no matter what we have done in our lives, no matter what atrocity, like Malvo did, there's always an opportunity to begin again. There's always an opportunity to redeem ourselves. And just like Paul or Saul on his way to Rome to Damascus, he had committed atrocities. But Jesus still looked at him and saw his potential. Let us look at one another and vibrate the potential that is in with each one of us. Thank you.